Good evening and welcome to the December 6, 2016 meeting of the Guilderland Board of Education. Would you all please silence your cell phones and rise for the Pledge of Allegiance?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
The first item on our agenda this evening is the High School Student Representative Report.
So just some events that are coming up. The Barnes Noble Book Fair will be on the 16th, and the High School Symphonic Band is on the 21st, in which the high school and the middle school are performing. The Ugly Sweater Contest will be on the 23rd. The yearbooks are on sale through December 16th for $60, and it will be for $65 until April 13th. For sports, there's an event or a game every night, which can be found on the athletic page. Thank you.
Thank you very much. The next item on our agenda is public comment number one. Linda, do we have anybody signed up? Okay. And now we will move on to our program report.
And I'm going to introduce Damian Singleton, who will kick off our program for tonight.
Okay, well, thank you, everyone. This is an exciting evening. We're very happy to have such a great audience, which is comprised mostly, I'm guessing, of parents and students who are here to participate in this presentation. So we're hoping to make this a fun night for you tonight. And for the board, I warn you, this will be a little bit interactive, so be ready to actually engage with your technology. And the good news, two points of good news. First, I already shared, we have a great cast of students here tonight to share with you some of their experiences with instructional technology, an amazing cast of teachers in the back of the room here, all of whom serve as our technology liaisons in addition to their regular role as a classroom teacher. So from Westmere, we have Sarah Richardson. Next to her is Natalia Lemoyne, who's our coordinator for instructional technology, Jessica Follinsby from Linwood, Keith Van Wagnen from Pinebush, Becky Waslow, who's from Guilderland Elementary, Bernie Bott from the high school, and tucked in there is Joe Winchester from the middle school. So they really serve as the pioneers in our buildings. They really lead the charge for use of instructional technology, but I think also transformation of instruction in the classroom. So I want to thank them all for their contributions to our school system and certainly to this presentation as well. I'm going to let them introduce the kids. We have many here, and there's no way that I can handle that right now, so I'm going to let them do that little piece. And then the second point of good news is you don't have to hear from me much tonight, so they will do most of the talking, which is great, and I'm very excited about that. So we titled this Welcome to the Future. It's an interesting title because we never know what the future will hold, especially when we talk about technology. Always changing, always adapting. I think our goal with instructional technology is to really prepare students to be adaptable as well and be flexible in their use of technology. So you will see many different applications tonight, some of which you will actually use. So again, be warned. But with that said, I'm going to turn it to Natalia Lemoyne to get the ball rolling.
Well, thank you, Damian, and good evening, everyone. So technology in Guilderland has different, it's seen in different ways, and it's represented in many different ways. Our educational technology integration happens at various levels. It takes different forms and is conducted through different avenues. So with guidance from the coordinator of instructional technology, teachers get support from technology liaisons and from myself through different avenues. The first one is the individual, the one-on-one and small group informal and formal interactions that take the form of meetings, co-planning, and co-teaching sessions. This is a great way for us as tech liaisons and for me to meet one-on-one with teachers, address those areas of need and target specific areas so that that translates into better instruction in the classroom and obviously better learning outcomes. Technology liaisons and myself also offer full-day professional development sessions for teachers from their buildings. And these sessions focus on the specific needs of their classes and school buildings. So not only the one-to-one, but we also have the traditional professional development model. Then we also have instructional videos, tutorials, and materials are also provided to support teachers in what they do every day. So thanks to these efforts, teachers and students have meaningful curriculum connections that utilize technology. Here are some highlights and examples, but before that, you get to experience some of what the teachers do in the classroom. So we're gonna try something together. And one of the things that we wanna do is call a Kahoot. Have you guys heard about Kahoot? You have, great. The kids have. All right, so members of the board, if you don't mind, open up your laptop, your Chromebook, and going into a new tab. We're gonna do a little Kahoot game today. And what I need you to do is go on to a new tab on your browser and you're gonna type in kahoot.it. When you get to that screen, you will be asked to type in a PIN number, and that is the PIN number that you need to type. It's telling me that I have four players joined. Do we need any assistance? We have plenty of helpers. There you go. Ten players, almost there. Ah, I think everyone is playing. That's fine. Looks like everybody's joined, and I have some people back there joining, I think. O-O-T. Yes.
Not it. Not one. Not it.
All right, get ready, because this game is for points. Oh. Okay. Should we start? Yeah. Are we ready to start?
No. Yeah. 1-8-2-7-5-3.
This man.
You got to type. Yeah.
All right, so the game of Kahoot, you will be presented with a screen that has a question and a multiple choice question and four choices. You have to think quick. You have 10 seconds to answer each question, and you will be playing for points, okay? So here we go. Yes. What is educational technology? These are your options.
Oh, yeah, right up there.
Sorry, I was not supposed to click on that.
That was correct. I didn't see anything.
Yeah, did it?
That time. The questions didn't come up, just these symbols.
Oh, no. Let's try the next one.
Nope, time's up. Just the symbols.
Oh. These are some of our top players here. Next question. So let's see who's the top scorer in this one. There you go, Chris.
Good guess.
Next question. Let's see who's got that one. Chris.
Superstar.
Good, Teresa's getting there.
Alan.
Question four. Right, let's see. Let's do full screen, actually. Thank you. Superstar. Last question. Let's see. Superstar got 3,000 points.
I'm second. Oh, superstar. I'm not superstar.
I would like to meet Superstar, actually.
Oh, superstar.
Good job, everyone. So this is just a little tease of Kahoot activity. This is done to introduce a topic or to review a topic. And I know some of the teachers here have used this Kahoot for many, many instructional purposes. So I hope you have enjoyed it. And let's go back to our presentation.
Questions.
We're going to continue with our middle school. So I'm going to hand it over to Joe Winchester. He's our technology liaison at that building.
Good evening. I'm Joe Winchester, as Natalia and Damian said. I work at the middle school. I teach 7th grade science this year, and I'm also our building tech liaison. I'm going to turn it over to our students. We have two wonderful students from the middle school. They're both 7th grade students, and they're really outstanding student leaders, so that's why they're here to represent their building today. We have Sam Sabodi and Emily DePew.
Technology can be used for assessment. It can be used as an informal or formal assessment. It can be a test or a quiz or just a simple check-in before, after, or during a lesson. If you want to do a check-in before, you could see what students already know. If you want to do a check-in during the lesson to see if kids are following along, and after to see if kids are retaining it and putting it all together. These assessments can be student or teacher created, and you can use them as self-assessment or peer assessment.
You could also, when you answer, it doesn't show your, when you answer, it doesn't show your name, so you can answer anonymously, but the teacher can see who answered what question also. I just wanted to add that.
Kahoot is similar to Pear Deck, which you just saw in the last section. It's a little bit more competitive than Pear Deck. Also, it doesn't show some of the lower scores. It only shows the top five and the highest climber. You can see on the top left how the questions looked. You can also see a graph answer or individual answers the teacher can see. And it is timed, which you also just saw.
Okay, what you see is Castle Learning. It is more of a formal assessment. The teacher can create a quiz, and then the students can take it. And the teacher can look back at what the students answered and go back to the not-so-successful questions that the students didn't do too well on and go back right from there and see what most kids answered and what they did wrong so that they can correct the students and help them learn.
Plickers is another type of multiple choice program. You can have answer distributions as well as individual answers, like you could see the graph on the top. So what Plickers is each student gets a card, and you ask a multiple choice question, and then they hold up the card to say A, B, C, or D on which side, and then the teacher scans it, and then you can see the answers over on the right.
Okay, so this is Google Forms. The teachers or the students can use this, and they can send out a form, and everyone that you send it to can take it, and then it shows you the feedback from everyone that took it. And you could call it a survey, or you could use it for a test, too.
This is Google Classroom or Google Drive. A really good thing about this is that you can never lose anything because it automatically saves to your drive from Classroom. It's accessible from anywhere, such as a mobile device or a tablet. You can't really forget anything at school, so that makes it a lot easier to get things done. And it also automatically gives every single person their own copy, which you can see up on the top. So that way, if you want to make changes to your document, it's not shared between everybody in the class, it's just only yours. Also, if you look on the bottom, that's the teacher view. So the teacher can see who's done with it and who's not done, but nobody else sees it, so it's just for the teacher to look at.
These are our digital portfolios. My team has been working on this for the whole year so far. We have been recording what we've been doing in science class, all of our labs, and we've added what we've done in LA, like our graphic organizer, we've added that. It's a really easy way to leave a positive footprint for you on the internet. We've also included the extracurricular activities to show that you're not just a student, but you're also well-rounded in all ways.
Here are just some icons for some of the mobile learning apps, such as Classroom and Kahoot. So this is just another way of showing that you can get these apps on your mobile device or on a tablet, and you can have it with you everywhere.
All right, thank you. Now it's turn to have Guilderland High School come on up.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Bernard Bott. I'm a librarian here at the high school, and I'm a research coordinator for the Equals MC Squared program, tech liaison, and I handle day-to-day operations, or at least pretend to, at the help desk. They're pretty much self-run. So about 3 years ago, we started the student help desk under the sage-like guidance of administration. And it's housed at the library. And what we do is just handle day-to-day problems or try to find solutions to day-to-day problems in all facets of technology throughout the school, students as well as teachers and faculty. We're here tonight, Matthew Creighton's here tonight to talk about the sort of natural evolution that the help desk should be taking. And 2 years ago, we started the Equals MC Squared program, which is an independent inquiry program. And Fabroni Mansour is going to speak to that a little bit and how we integrate technology with that. First up is Matthew.
Thank you, Mr. Bott. So one of the things about the help desk is just day-to-day operations. We're in the library, and not only do students work with the librarians and other students, but they're also working with staff, administrators, teachers, and the other paid technology staff as well. This helps to ensure that sense of ownership in the school's technology organization. So we're trying to bridge that gap between teachers, administrators, and students as well, because students, we find, are a great resource about these emerging technologies that everyone just seems to use, and the kids just naturally seem to pick them up and adapt to. We have about 32 students here at the help desk, and the only prerequisite to join is that they have this willingness to learn. So we don't want or don't necessarily need people who are masters in all senses of technology. We want people who want to learn. Typically, we'll take someone who knows technology very well and someone who's new to different forms of technology, and we'll send them on the same job. So that's a learning experience for both students and for the teacher who submitted the help as well. But the help desk and the technicians, Chad Sheffer and Dan Crother, we use this program called Spiceworks. That's our online ticketing software. There we go. Great, thank you. Again, that's our online ticketing program. If teachers have any problems, whether it be hardware, software, audio problems, Chromebook enrollment, they can just go online to the district intranet and fill out a ticket on Spiceworks. And then with about 2 days, we'll have someone go to that classroom and help them one-on-one. And again, just like any other business or institution, data and statistics about how we're doing in the school and community is really vital to, again, improve the help desk and take us in new directions. And one way we do that is through Google Forms. So after every job that we complete with a teacher, we send an email with a Google Form and just with some basic questions and comments and feedback to really see what went well, what didn't went well, and maybe what we can improve upon in the future, all again to make the help desk better as we move along. Based on this feedback, we learned something that really could help teachers when we're not in the classroom is making a website for all teachers and staff in the district to go to. That's our technology online database that was created last year. It's in the bottom right-hand corner of the slide. And we find that's really helpful because teachers can just go online and about every single tool that we use in the district, whether it be hardware or software, is available for teachers to go on. And there's different instructions, videos, tutorials made by students using a program called Screencast-O-Matic. And these student-made videos just have basic tutorials about the different forms of technology, how they can use it, how they can integrate it into the classroom. And again, we're not sequestered. We're not sequestered in the back of the library. We are constantly moving out on jobs using, again, Spiceworks, enforcing the internet acceptable use policy, wherever we see fit, a lot of times the library, just simple reminders about maybe better digital citizenship practices that we can better. And again, for the past two summers, we've had Guilderland students actually intern over the summer, and these students have been really helpful to the paid technology staff with setting up different new sources of technology, trying out new sources, being voices for what they think will actually be beneficial to students. And the nice thing about this is we have a student voice in the district and the different uses of technology that we have. So whether it be different types of Chromebooks, ways we can use it, a lot of times students in classrooms will just pipe up a little bit of advice to the teachers and say, oh, you know, maybe we can use this to teach a lesson, or maybe we can create a Google site. And that way when we go home at night, we have a website with all these different resources that we can use. And again, these help us students. We're trying to make them leaders, all 32 of them, not just a couple. We do have some managers, though, Micro Valley, Anish Nayak, and Summit Vora. And this year they created a Google Classroom like the one up there. And again, that's just to help facilitate meetings, disperse meeting notes, and just share information and updates. And Google Classroom is a great source of, of the online classroom, just to increase collaboration, again, amongst all the help desk members, since we don't see each other throughout the day. We're all dispersed throughout four blocks. My apologies. And again, the next logical step for the help desk that we would like to see in the future is increasing instructional technology and professional development. The last superintendent conference day, myself, Fibronia, and Ralphie taught our own different classes with Google Sites and Lucid Press and Classroom and Audacity. And these are just some different tools that we find would be really helpful for teachers to integrate into their classrooms. I know in my class that I taught, for example, we had about 20 teachers who have never used Google Classroom or Google Sites. We were able to help them set up their own site, and within the next week, they had their Google Site and Google Classroom up and running, and they were pushing different resources and different websites and cool links to their students. And so we find this is really beneficial, and we'd only like to further this progress, because we really find the teachers are receptive to the students. They really know what's happening in the help desk, and just with technology in the world, and we're always ready to help teachers, and so they're a great resource. And again, using this technology to its fullest potential, we're also solving problems, and with more on that, Fibronia.
Thank you, Matt. E equals MC squared is GHS's independent research program. The class itself is built upon the theory that students learn best when they are motivated through their own curiosity. So the program is currently in its second year, and it offers a guided as well as an open inquiry level
of the course. Both questioning and inquiry skills are integral in the success of this class, and a variety of technology is used to incorporate the four C's that are central to deeper thought: creativity, collaboration, communication, and critical thinking. So through Google Sites, EMC students who are in the first year of the program are given a digital portfolio to store and catalog assignments and progress. Attaching files and navigating the intricacies of Google is important in showcasing creativity and making public our progress through blogging, which we'll get to in a bit. In the open inquiry level of the course, we are given free rein over our sites, and instead of having a preloaded one available at the beginning of the year, each open inquiry student is responsible for creating and managing their own site. One avenue for portfolios has been expanding into Wix. This offers a different format for creativity, as we can see in Senior Priyan Patharana's site, where he is chronicling his project, the Human API. Additionally, WordPress has shown itself to be a substantial outlet for expressing creativity and displaying progress. I chose to use WordPress mainly for its versatility in being both a website and a blog. Although some nuances have proven tedious in managing my site, I've learned much about the capabilities that an online profile possesses when trying to reach a larger population. So one of the fundamental characteristics of the open inquiry level of EMC is the use of a media platform by which we push out our projects to a larger audience. For example, Rafi Nizam, a senior working through his project, A Critique of Education, has been recording podcasts through Audacity and sharing those on his Wix site. For my project, I am using an app called Periscope, where I try to inspire virtual discourse, and I talk about, from week to week, the information I'm learning about, the different articles that I read, and any ideas that I've synthesized over the past week. Anyone who is watching the broadcast can contribute through a commenting feature on the app. Through Periscope, it has become quite apparent to me how important communication and collaboration really are to the learning process, because it provides a place to truly assess one's mentality in the occasion of hearing others' opinions. So connecting these projects to something larger than GHS is very crucial to ensure that they are not just insulated in the walls of the school. EMC students blog about successes, failures, and resources that they have used to inform their research. This provides yet another platform for everyone interested to read and view our thoughts. Some are really quite fascinating. Silma Suba, a first-year EMC student, is studying dreams. As you can see, her blog is her own. This is where creativity, critical thinking, collaboration, communication can truly come together in one place to showcase that unity between the four C's. For the past 2 years, our EMC program has used new technologies to tackle projects. By using a credit card-sized computer called a Raspberry Pi, we have two students this year who are looking to build robots as their springboard to remotely operating a machine. With that, I invite you to listen to our podcast. We use the program Audacity to record interviews and checkpoint meetings with our coordinators, Mr. Bott and Mrs. Gergen. You can view all of our websites and listen to these recordings by visiting bit.ly/GuildelandEMC2, and that is the number 2, as you can see up there. If you have any questions, please feel free to contact any of the students about our particular projects or research coordinators, Mr. Bott and Mrs. Gergen. We are truly excited to see what heights EMC as well as Helpdesk will reach this year and in the years to come. Thank you.
Thank you, Fabronia and Matt. Outstanding job, obviously. Now we're moving on to our first elementary school, Westmere.
So as you can see, there are some pretty amazing things going on in our middle school and high school. And what we're going to do now is just take you on a little journey through each elementary school to kind of show you where they start building these foundations. So each elementary school has chosen one or two things to kind of focus a little bit more on and give you a snapshot of how we're using technology in our buildings. So with me, I have four co-presenters from Westmere. Have Mackenzie Katie, who's a first... Come on up! She's a first grader this year, and Sulaf Khatib, who is a second grader who was in my room last year, and then we have two fourth graders who I did not teach, but they've had wonderful teachers at Westmere, and they're both in fourth grade in Mrs. O'Brien's classroom. We have Ethan Coluccio and Lauren Wasserbeck. And what we're going to show you is a little bit about Seesaw. And Seesaw is a website, or it's an app, that our students are using at Westmere. Over half of the teachers at Westmere are currently using Seesaw in their classrooms. And what it is used for is to document learning throughout the year. So you get a really clear snapshot of how these students are doing on a daily basis, a weekly basis, depending on how often they post, through their own pictures, videos, links. They can put any doc on there from their Google Docs, Google Slides. It's a pretty awesome way to document growth. And it also goes directly to parents, so they have a really great window into what they're learning. So, you don't want to hear from me anymore. We're just going to show you some examples of how we're using Seesaw in the classroom. Mackenzie's going to start us off, our first grader from Westmere.
We've been doing mystery Skypes. We've mystery Skyped with Missouri, Kansas, and Iowa. I posted a video about Kansas. Yesterday we mystery Skyped with Kansas for our second mystery Skype. Kansas is next to Missouri and Nebraska. It would take 19 days to walk from New York to Kansas.
And next we have Sulaf, who's going to tell about her entry.
Last year we thought about specific animals, and then we wrote about the animals. Then we recorded our books on Shadow Puppet. Then we sent the recording from Shadow Puppet to Seesaw. What I have here is a video about what I wrote about my recording. I wrote about bees. I hope you enjoyed the video.
All About Bees by Sula. Buzz, buzz, what is that? It is a bee. Read this book to learn more about bees. Bees live in beehives. Bees live there because habitat. Bees lived in beehives. Bees live there because they have to make honey.
She had a lot more information in there. You'll have to check it out later. You'll learn a lot about bees. So now I'd like to take a moment to highlight these fourth graders and their teacher, Mrs. O'Brien, who are doing, they're doing some pretty awesome things in math on Seesaw.
So a couple of weeks ago, we had to do like math tests, but on Seesaw. And on the front, we would either say if we're completely fluent, almost fluent, becoming fluent, or still needing to become fluent. And then people would watch our video and see, and they would comment on which level of fluency we were at, if we made any fact errors, and we cannot pause the video, and we have to read from the back with all the math facts on it.
In the beginning of our videos, viewers are asked to leave a comment telling us on how they think we did with our math facts. You may comment that we are fluent and did a great job, or you may comment that we are not quite there yet and add some words for encouragement, like almost there, nice job, keep it up. And that's how you comment on Seesaw.
practice the fact families of 8, 9, and 10. I believe that I am completely fluent, which means I will not miss any, and I will recall all of my facts under 5 seconds. Please view my video and comment on, number 1, which level of fluency you think I am at, 2, point out any factors that I may have made, 3, and 3, comment on the speed of my recall. Is it under 5 seconds for each fact? Was there a fact that took longer than 5 seconds? And then I'm not fluent. Thank you so much for helping making me more fluent in my multiplication class. Here I go. 10 times 5 is 50, 9 times 6 is 54, 8 times 7 is 56.
So I think you probably get the gist. There's just a lot of ways for students to be able to capture their learning, reflect on their learning, share their learning with others, and it's a great way for teachers to have a little window into their students' brains, and I feel like I know my students better than I ever have in my 10 years because of Seesaw and the way that they're able to talk through their thinking. So I'm going to turn it over to... Rebecca Walslow from Guilderland Elementary School.
Hi, as Sarah said, I'm Becky Walslow. I teach fifth grade at Guilderland Elementary, and I'm here with some very special guests. You just saw a little teeny glimpse of Mystery Skype in first grade, but my guests are going to share with you what that looks like in a fifth grade classroom and all the benefits that come out of using Skype in the classroom. So please welcome Maddie Hammes, Hannah Weckler, and Aiden Pike.
Hi, I'm Hannah Weckler, and we would sometimes start off our day with Mystery Skype. Basically, with Mystery Skype, you split up into jobs, like people who ask the questions and people who make up the questions. Sometimes we would do it live, or we'd take video clips and send it to wherever the person was. And this Mystery Skype didn't only teach us map skills, but also teamwork and collaboration. Here's a video clip on one of our video Mystery Skypes.
Hi, I'm Hannah.
And I'm Maddie.
Yes, we are in the Northern Hemisphere. Are you in the Western
Hemisphere?
My
name is Terrence. No, we are not in the Western Hemisphere. Our question is, are you between the North Atlantic Ocean and the North Pacific Ocean?
I'm Daniel.
And I'm Megan.
And yes, we are between the North Atlantic and North Pacific. Good job.
Does your continent border the North Pacific Ocean?
My name is Trevor, and my name is
Sophie. Yes, our continent borders the North Pacific Ocean.
Our question is your continent North America?
My name is Jolene.
Hello, my name is June.
Selamat datang, nama saya Ariana.
Yes, our city has two words. Great job.
Is your city near Niagara?
We are not near Niagara Falls.
Are you in Shawalong?
Hi, I'm Erin.
Hi, I'm Nana.
Yes, we're in Shawalong.
Yeah!
Are you in Albany?
Hello from?
Skyping with us. I hope you had a good time.
Thank you!
Hi, I'm Aiden Pike. As you can see, we had to use mapping and geography skills in order to find the other class. We would often ask questions using latitude and longitude, landforms, time zones, and population. We'd have to work together and think strategically.
Hi, I'm Maddie Hammes. Mystery Skype was just an all-around unique experience. Mystery Skype was one of my favorite things to do in school. We made new friends all over the world. From New Jersey and Maine to Malaysia and Russia, we've seen a lot of diverse cities and countries. So many places, sometimes thousands of miles away, talking to us live. We continue to collaborate with a classroom in Malaysia and partnered up on a project using Google Slides. We learned a lot about their culture and temperatures, and I personally found that I had a lot in common with my partner, including the same favorite book, which was crazy since they're over 8,000 miles away.
Using Skype in the classroom gave us an authentic way to put our geography and map skills to work. We spoke to students from every part of the globe. We became more connected and more aware of our world.
Here's Linwood.
Hello, everyone. My name is Jessica Follinsby. I'm a fourth grade teacher at Linwood Elementary, and I'm also the building's technology liaison. I wanted to share with you part of Linwood's journey with utilizing technology in the classroom. One of the areas of our focus is to focus on literacy and how we could utilize technology to support our already existing literacy program. So I reached out to Nell Ball, who is our literacy coach for our building, and we decided that we would come together and provide professional development to teachers so that we could help teachers teach students to utilize technology into the classroom. So Nell's going to share with us a little bit about what our journey was and how where our area of focus was for providing the professional development.
So Jess and I got talking about how do we stay true to good literacy teaching while incorporating technology into our reading and writing workshops, with the idea of using technology as a tool to support the reader and the writer rather than focusing on just the technology itself, but helping kids build a sense of agency in themselves to understand how can I use technology to support me as a learner. And so a couple of things we did was kind of think about, you know, when is it appropriate to be composing on a Chromebook a piece for writing workshop, and when is it not, and having kids try to identify that. For some children, composing right on a computer benefits them, and they're able to really fluently get their ideas down. For other kids, they're still choosing to write with paper and pencil. So that agency of deciding and teaching them, like having them self-reflect, what helps me communicate those ideas better? In reading, sometimes our students are reading more and more digitally, and what sort of skills do they need to be able to be a digital reader? Because it's different than reading a traditional text. And so to really do a close read and to really understand and take in information, we want to be able to support them in teaching those skills. If I'm reading a digital text, what do I need to be able to do? And so Jess and I kind of collaborated together, and we came up with a professional development to support our teachers in thinking of these things and then also figuring out how they could incorporate this into their classrooms. And, you know, we picked a couple apps, but one of the things I'll just share quickly is Padlet is just a digital bulletin board. I mean, it's a very simple app that you can use, but one of the things we had them thinking about, it's almost like we have kids use Post-its all the time to mark their thinking, and it was a way that they could probably be reading a book, a traditional text, and have their Chromebook next to them and have a Padlet open and use that to mark their thinking like they would on a Post-it note in their book. And so we've just been able to work together in thinking about how can we use technology in authentic and connected and intentional ways within our workshop, almost having a workshop of possibility, combining traditional and digital means.
So we have two friends here. We have Rachel and Han, who are going to share with us some of their favorite digital means for technology.
Last year, Mrs. Follinsby's classroom, she would push out assignments to us on Google Classroom instead of passing out papers. I like this because it helped me stay more organized, and I wouldn't have lots of folders and papers. Instead, my folders and papers were on Google Classroom.
All of our writing was done on Google Docs. I enjoyed using this because it was an easier and way more efficient way to write it.
One of my favorite features was the comic section. I could peer comic on my classmates' writing pieces. Ms. Fonsby would also use this feature to help us grow as writers. She would ask questions like, how could you, instead of telling us exactly what needed to be fixed. This helped me think about what needed to be changed instead of being told what needed to be fixed.
So those are just a couple examples of how we use technology to help support our literacy program.
Hi there, I'm Keith Van Wagnen. I'm a third grade teacher and the technology liaison at Pine Bush Elementary School. I have three third graders with me, Elijah, Young, and Angelie. I want to take 1 second, come on up, the three of you. 6 years ago, Febronia was actually one of my fifth grade students, and she was an amazing student then, but watching what she can do right now, that really is a testament to just how wonderful the Guilderland school system is and just how creative our students become. So really, really wonderful, Febronia. So two of the programs that we use in third grade, one is the keyboarding program that the district adopted. And my two young guys here are going to tell you a little bit about their experiences with Typing Agent. And Angelie is going to tell you about KidBlog. I heard Febronia talking about her kid, or her blogging about her experiences here. I actually start blogging with the kids in third grade. And one of the things that I really like about the blogging is its authenticity. I pose a question and they comment about the question, but then the other kids in the classroom are also asked to make a comment about or a response about a comment that somebody else has made. And some of those comments are also critiques. So they're assisting each other, not just with how they write, but also the grammatical and the writing style and punctuation, capitalization stuff that's in there. So who would like to start? You want to talk about keyboarding? All right.
Today we're going to show you Typing Agent. Typing Agent is about typing and getting fluent in typing. I like Typing Agent because it helps us for typing and make us more faster at typing. I like Typing Agent because there's something called leaderboard practice, and they tell you who's in like first place, and second place, and third place.
I like Typing Agent because you can tell. You learn how to. So there are different units, and once you complete the first unit, then you can move on to the second. And there's a lot of units that you can move on in, and it's a lot of fun.
KidBlog is one of our ways to blog to other people. Our teacher will send us a post, and we will blog to it. We can also send replies so we can correct other people, and we can make sure that they stay happy about their blog to our teacher. Today's blog was about make me change. So we were supposed to change something in our class, like changing our desk, so we would be back together. Yesterday's was about banana split ice cream. That is Mr. V's favorite ice cream. We were trying to make him not choose that ice cream, and we would either disagree or agree. We would try to persuade other people to like that ice cream, or we would try to persuade Mr. V to like our type of ice cream.
All right, thank you. Damien?
Well, first I have to thank everyone for your amazing contribution to tonight's presentation to the board. I'm sorry, I know we're going a little bit long here, but as we thought about a presentation about technology, we felt that it was absolutely critical that you hear some student voices. And I think I'll echo, I think it was Keith who just referenced Fabronia and how she was as a fifth grader and now how she is as a young adult in her high school. And I think you just saw evidence of really growth in sophistication, growth in knowledge and skill and expertise in their use of technology, and I think much of that, if not all of that, is owed to our teachers as well, so thank you to you as well. But looking forward, I just want to give you a glimpse into some of our next steps, but I want to reference really where we've come in a very short period of time, and I'm looking around this room because I see things like wireless access points in our ceiling. Just a couple of years ago, we would not have been able to do what we did with you with Kahoot, because we needed infrastructure to be able to do that. We have, I think, vastly, vastly improved our infrastructure in our district, which enables us to vastly, vastly improve the instructional practice in the classroom. So for that, I want to thank the board for their support of that. There's still work to, there will always be work to be done, of course, but the improvements, they make the difference. They really do make the difference, so thank you for that. But looking forward, there is a person that I look to for some inspiration and ideas often. His name is Chris Lehman, and Chris Lehman was the founding principal of a public high school in the city of Philadelphia called the Science Leadership Academy. And he founded that high school back in 2006, I believe. And when he did so with the insistence that it be a technology-rich environment to the point where he insisted that every single student in that high school had their own laptop provided by the school. And he was really the first person that I became aware of that introduced this idea of a one-to-one learning environment. And there's a quote that always sticks with me from him, and that quote is that technology needs to be like oxygen in a school. It has to be ubiquitous, it has to be necessary, and it has to be invisible. Those were his three conditions for instructional technology. Most importantly, however, he wanted the technology in the hands of students. We're getting there. I would say we're getting there, especially with the investment by New York State in the Smart Schools plan. So I think the board is familiar. I don't know how much the audience knows about it, but the state basically injected funds to school districts to improve the use of technology within their schools. So we've had our plan in the hands of the state awaiting the approval from the state. But one of the big moves forward that we are actively exploring, particularly at our middle level right now, is the idea of a one-to-one program. And really that idea of having a device for every single student, which we will be there once we have the funds from the Smart School program and the purchases underway. So I just wanted to highlight a couple of goals for a one-to-one program in our high school, and that will carry into our at our middle school, and it will carry into our high school in following years as well. So really what we are hoping to accomplish, we're hoping, of course, to improve student learning, to expand transformative learning, meaningful student engagement through technology, 21st century skills, which I think you heard and witnessed so many of them tonight, communication, collaboration, critical thinking, connection, global connections, and equity of access is a critical piece as well, because we often hear, well, what about students who don't have access to the technology that they need to be successful? And that is one of the underlying goals of a one-to-one program. So the middle school building cabinet, I had the pleasure of going to their last building cabinet meeting with Natalia Lemoyne to really begin exploring this formally. We had a visitation today to Queensbury, where they have started their one-to-one program at Queensbury in Glens Falls, where they're in their second year of that. And again, that goal is to have the technology in the hands of students. As much as we pride ourselves on the technology that we have in our district, and these teachers have demonstrated that they use it and use it well, we also have pockets where we still don't have the technology there. So a one-to-one would help us to accomplish that, and there certainly will be more to come regarding that effort. And with that, I'll wrap it up, and then any questions that we might have from the board. Seema.
I think someone brought up the topic of digital literacy, and I was just curious, at what stage in, you know, K-12 do they start talking about that in terms of, like, students being, you know, becoming like a savvy consumer of the type of information that they get when they use the technology?
The me to end? You guys can jump in at any point. I think we start talking about digital citizenship at the moment that we hand students technology and they are engaged in it. And I think that starts as early as kindergarten. Several years ago, we developed a K through 12 scope and sequence for technology skill development. And that's part of it. So we have it outlined so that at each grade level, there are certain skills and experiences that students have to engage in. Our library media specialists are very, very active in the digital citizenship world and the instructional end of that as well. They support that effort. They use a lot of technology, certainly at the elementary, with something called Common Sense Media. That comes into play as a great resource for that as well. And I will put in a little shameless plug. Next week we have Chris Vollum, who will be here talking about safe and constructive use of social media at all levels. He'll be at all of our schools, and we'll have a parent and community forum Monday night here in this room. So it's an ongoing conversation. I think it's something that we have to stay on top of, because you always have, especially in the world of social media, you always have new applications that are coming on the scene. You know, some of them are used well and used constructively, sometimes they're not, so that digital citizenship conversation is really, it's very critical, and it's ongoing. Feel free to jump in.
Yeah, I wanted to add just a quick thing. Solid professional development is
I just wanted to add a quick thing. Some of the professional development that the tech liaisons design is usually based on one of the items in the technology scope and sequence, or the digital literacy scope and sequence that we've developed. Also, I know that Westmere, for example, does extensive work with professional development for teachers based on those skills. And at the middle school, there's a technology subcommittee that works really extensively with that technology scope and sequence as well. And they develop, like I said, professional development gear based on those technology skills that we've outlined.
The scope and sequence you referred to, we've developed that. Is there anything, as the state or nationally, done anything in terms of helping define the scope and sequence?
Yes, there is something nationally called the ESTE standards, and we've actually based our own on our own digital sequence, scope and sequence, on those standards. There's also Common Sense Media, as you mentioned before. We try to gather as much as we can to be as accurate as we can with the skills. But yeah, the national standards are the ESTE standards.
That's okay.
I just have a question about the one-to-one program with the smart schools. Is the plan, I know it hasn't been implemented yet, but is it starting high school, middle school, and how are all those decisions made?
Well, that's part of the reason we're engaging the building cabinet at the middle school. Right now, we have to remember we have really multiple generations of Chromebooks in our district already that we've acquired over recent years. And that's great, but when you go to a one-to-one, you also have to think about what's the lifespan, when do they become end-of-life devices, when do you have to replace them. So what we're looking at right now is starting the one-to-one approach at grade 5 with the devices remaining in school. So the devices would stay in school at grade 5. At 6, 7, and 8, the big decision point that we have to really wrestle with is, do they take them home? So I know that sounds frightening. I know that that's a little nerve-wracking. But if you think about it as really the same thing that we have done for decades with textbooks, these are essentially their textbooks now. We don't buy a lot of big, giant textbooks anymore. And the cost point of the Chromebooks that we're utilizing at this point are really not much more than the cost of a big giant textbook. So there's a lot to think about logistically with that. There's a lot that we still have to plan out. But I would say the big decision that we're really trying to tackle at the middle level right now is, do we send the devices home with kids? Queensbury, I referenced that earlier, they send them home. Glens Falls sends them home. Shenandoah has started a one-to-one program likewise, and that's the more common practice, is to really provide that resource to students, allow them to personalize that resource, allow them to really, you know, make it a seamless part of their learning experience, both in school and at home as well. So still in conversation, but I'm optimistic that we're moving in a really good direction.
Thank you. I just wanted to thank the students and the teachers for coming. I know it's kind of late for the kids, so thanks.
Alec. With the one-to-one, how are you going to handle the cybersecurity and all the things that have to do with hacking all these devices that go on in today's world?
Yeah, well, there's a real advantage to using Chromebooks, and that is that we can manage them both here and at home. So they're a little bit different than a PC or a MacBook. I won't go into all the technical details with that, but all of our students with their Google accounts, they're managed really by Natalia. She's our primary administrator for our Google system. So it's different than what we traditionally engage with a Windows machine or a Macintosh machine, where we would still manage those devices and control those devices from a remote location from here, essentially.
I also wanted to add that being a district device, we also provide filtering for it. And our filtering service for our computers here in the district go through our filter, and these devices will also go through the same filter. So there is extra protection there. We also just wanted you to know that we also have two-step verification for our sign-in for Google Apps. So.
Barbara.
The typing agent program that the kids mentioned that they enjoyed, is that a requirement? And if so, at what age level, and do they have to test out of it? How does it work?
We started at really grade 2-ish to 3-ish, I would say. I say ish because it's kind of a gray area. We did a lot of research around when it's appropriate to have students engage in a formal typing program. So it's really around that grade span between grade 2 and grade 3, and I think we have it formally in our grade 3 scope and sequence. I think there is definitely some dabbling with it that takes place at grades 2, but it's really grade 3 and beyond where it becomes a little bit more formal.
By the end of grade 3, all our students will be able to type.
To the degree that we can possibly get them to type, yes.
Well, I mean, it's
remember, they're
our,
third
it's
graders.
It's part of our curriculum. It's just not just something that they do during recess time or fun time. Or
no. Any other questions? All right. Again, I want to thank the parents for bringing your wonderful children out tonight, and thank you to all of our amazing kids and teachers as well. We're going to let you go, but thank you again. So have a good night.
Okay, still going? Really?
Just get it comfortable. Just get it comfortable. Like it's sit.
Yeah. You have a drink tonic water?
tonic, was La Paz a tonic water?
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Oh, my God.
So the next item on the agenda is our 2017-2018 budget development discussion. I think it makes sense to maybe go around the table and everybody identify the priorities and their reasons why. So maybe, Kathy, do you want to start?
Oh, sure.
Okay, well, I went through the list and I noted that there are a couple things. Well, actually, I have two priorities that kind of come from the list, and one that actually will take a little bit more explaining because it doesn't. But the first one was providing more enhanced learning opportunities. And I think that was mentioned by a lot of people, including increasing student access to advanced and enriched courses, increasing internships, other learning opportunities through partnerships with local businesses, learning enhancement. K-12 was mentioned in board priorities numerous times, and it also was discussed pretty extensively at the council meeting. We had the very helpful minutes of that, and there were a lot of references to concepts and proposals for a lot of additional courses, as I'm sure you noted. So I would just say, in general, just enhanced learning opportunities as a priority. Another thing that was mentioned a lot and by a lot of people, and also a number of administrators was an increase in social work. I don't have any specific knowledge of that, but it seems that there must be some needs in this area because it was mentioned so many times, and also by, I think, at least two different schools as needing an increase in this area. I know that the board also mentioned a number of times increasing TAs. I noted that the leadership council seemed to give much more attention to increasing social work instead of TAs. I know that I'm the liaison to Altamont, and I know it came up PTA, at least, that TAs were, that additional TA time would be helpful in kindergarten because they had full classes, but I just kind of throw that in there. So. and my third one, I didn't actually put it on my priority list because I hadn't really thought about it, but I noticed that Cliff mentioned it in the council, and that's the condition of the cobblestone school. And I don't know how many of you have ever actually seen it or kind of been by it, but it's a really interesting old one-room schoolhouse. It's made of cobblestone construction, and it's very, the roof in particular is in bad condition. And what happened was, I happened to go to an open house this weekend at a place called the Minders Frederick House, mm-hmm. and it's really close to the Cobblestone School. It's a very interesting old house, and the garden club decorates it really nicely for the holidays. And we were there, and also at the house were some members of the Guilderland Historical Society, and they mentioned that a neighbor of the Cobblestone School, someone who lived right near there, had been complaining that there's holes in the roof. So it kind of, and they also mentioned that they had previously given tours of the building. It used, when they they have records in that building. They have like a file cabinet full of old Guilderland Historical Society records. And the interesting thing about that building too, which I don't know if anyone's ever seen inside. I mean, if you go and peek through the window, you can see it's actually kind of a time capsule of the school. Like, it's got a pot-bellied stove. It's got all the school desks. Mm-hmm. It's got maps on the walls. It's got, it's almost like somebody at the end of the school you know, term or whatever, locked the door and intended to come back and never did, and it's just like it was. So it's kind of fascinating. So I think it's interesting too that addition to our agenda right now, a late addition is that is a museum in the streets in Altamont, and I know that Maria had put that on the agenda, and there was a little blurb about how Guilderland Schools wanted to partner, you know, with Altamont to particularly, I guess, there's a spot of the old Altamont High School. Is that, yeah. So I think that kind of tracks right into this, you know, that history is important and we own this school and it's kind of falling apart. And so I just put it on my priority list. So that's kind of a long explanation, but you know, I thought I should explain it because, you know, it wasn't previously on there, but literally just kind of thought about it and actually went and looked at it and kind of observed the condition of the roof, you know, kind of, I mean, I'm not a contractor, but it didn't look very good. And, you know, kind of, you can peek in the window and see the inside just like it is. So anyway, that's all I have to say.
Thank you.
That wasn't on my list of priorities, but I have mentioned it to Neil and Linda. What can we do? And they have worked on tracking down how we can do something about it or what we can do. I'm not sure rehabilitating, it's nice, but what would we use it for?
I mean, I don't know if everybody knows that it's actually on the National Register of Historical Places.
Okay, I didn't know that. Okay. My concerns, and part of it, well, I believe we need to get the social work aspect back up to a full-time social worker in each school. And I would love to see TAs increased, obviously, you know, that's near and dear to my heart. But I go into Linwood 3 times a week as a volunteer into the fourth grade for half an hour each of those days in 3 different rooms. And the difference that it makes to a student to have somebody who can help them, reassure them, guide them maybe where they need to go is enormous. And if we could find a way to increase TA time, I know it would make a great deal of difference to the students, but I also think we need to really look at the social work. And part of that, somebody put focus family, and I think they were probably talking about the high school, but it all helps to give that hand to the kids, and I just think that makes an enormous difference. So the social work or teaching assistants, both of those, at least in one of them, are listed together, and I would love to see that. I think our language program probably needs some more support. The ENL, certainly, but also languages, if we could find a way to get that back into the elementary school. But I don't want to do it if it was going to be a short-term solution. I think it needs to be, we have to be able to see a way to continue funding it. But in our larger world that we live in now, I think languages are extremely important to our students. I'd like to see if we could get enrichment back at the elementary school. Again, it's just opening more doors for the students, and I know the teachers do as much as they can, but it was valuable when we had somebody there who was actually leading that in each of the schools. And that's probably more than 3, but also the focus students. And I think this was probably my comment, getting them back out into the community because it makes such a difference to them. As we saw at the luncheon when they talk about how much it means to them to go out into the community. And I'm not sure that's a big financial investment, but I think educationally it makes a huge difference to these students to be part of the community and in the community. And if we can help them do that, I think that would be wonderful. So before I get into 5 and 6 and more, there are some ideas.
Less 5, Judy.
Okay, before I get into 6 and 7.
Sure.
think at the end of this, if we all email Linda our, you know, our three priorities, I think that would help. I mean, I feel bad that Linda's trying to write all this down. You know, well. So I think that we all have it probably on a piece of paper, and I don't mind emailing it afterwards. I know Gloria already did that. I think that'd be helpful. So you're not trying to find on the list what we're talking.
If you know where it is on the list, that would be of great help.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. We're going to take the three, and then we'll email to Linda.
Or the five.
No, you only get three.
You can list five. Linda's only going to write three.
Good, Chris.
She gets to choose.
Okay, sure. Thank you, Chris. That would probably be helpful. Gloria?
It was very hard to say the three, I'll tell you. My three are, first, to continue the professional development activities for the co-teaching model with the goal of establishing the inclusive classrooms we began last year at all levels. So to continue in that area. Two, I would like to see us to support additional ENL staff to meet the growing student need in this area. I think this is something we have to do. My third one, like Kathy, I'll put with some comments because it's hard to explain it. It kind of came to me at looking at a lot of things in the list. I think it's more important than ever that we develop civic-minded individuals who can think critically. These past 18 months have made it very clear to me that the existence of our democratic society depends on an informed and engaged citizenry. All of our students must be capable of evaluating information for relevancy and validity, information which is coming at a faster and faster rate, weighing arguments, discerning fact from fiction, etc. I respect and support the steps we've taken in the areas of STEM education, but I am concerned that we are not putting enough resources into the further developing of the humanities courses so that they can meet the needs of today's students who are tomorrow's citizens.
Thank you for that, Gloria. Mm-hmm. Chris?
Sure. My three are, the first one was, I know we keep on talking about later school start time, but I think it's time that we actually act. I've been on the board now for 3 years, and I can't recall the number of conversations, but there have been a lot of conversations all showing that the high school should be a later start time, and I think that we should be switching definitely high school and elementary school start time. I've talked to parents from the high school, and the time that the kids have to get here in order to be here for 7:30, especially on the bus. One parent was telling me how much better it is now that his son can drive because he doesn't have to leave so much earlier, you know, in the morning. So I think it's one of these things that we talk and talk and talk about, and you guys showed evidence, you and Barbara, but we don't ever act, and I think it's time to act. The second thing is, I know we made financial cuts at one point, but I think it's time to add back, as Judy mentioned, the TAs. I think the elementary schools should get together, and we might not be able to do it for every classroom, but which classrooms, what support do they need? Is it TAs, you know, you mentioned social work. What do they need in those classrooms? I know the budget won't probably allow us to do it for every classroom, but I think we should target it. And the third thing is, I think that in our budget, I know we always keep it whatever it was last year, I think in our budget we should assume that we're gonna have the maximum number of school days and not the minimum school days. I know at the end of last year's budget, when you guys all saw all these goodies, of course you're going to pick the goodies, not that option. But I think if we include that in the budget, I think it'll be a better step. And then the fourth thing, I didn't include this because I don't think it fits in our category. I didn't write it, but it was about inclusion and making sure that we get the proper information about the funding, review the expansion, what the cost is, and looking at, you know, whether or not the program is a success. We talked about the math, and when we switch it from 2 years to 1 year, you know, we're supposed to look back and see, did those test scores improve? And I know under our new system, when it's a non-agenda item, we talked about we should put up this to vote, and we're not going to do that today, but I think at one of our meetings we should talk about that and actually get a good report on what we're doing with inclusion, what the costs are, and is it working.
We do have that scheduled for January 10th.
Perfect.
Job, Chris.
Thank you.
Good job.
Alan?
Good job, everybody. Actually, okay. My priorities are kind of pretty simple. I'm big on being able to be ready for when they graduate from high school, and I think our K-12 programming has to look at many types of different programs because not everybody's going to be college ready. So, I mean, I think we need to look at the skill set that's going to take in order to be successful in tomorrow's world, and some of which will be trade people, some will be professional people, some will be doctors and the like. So I would like to see us better track and measure how well we're doing when people leave our school to make sure that they are ready for tomorrow. I see lots of examples where a lot of kids come out of high school and they drift for a few years because they really don't have the skill set to be able to function in the world. The other thing that I think is important, especially in the technology that we're in today, I think we need to focus back on some citizenship skills. I think bullying has become there was a lot of emphasis on it in the past, and I think that it has resurfaced itself just in some of the matters that we've had to discuss in the meetings over the last year or two. There's been an increased presence of poor citizenship, and I think we need to emphasize that, you know, we're a global society, and there's a lot of tools out there, and they all need to be used with a great degree of caution and concern. I agree with Gloria, Chris, and Judy about the, as my third priority is, I think we need to look at where we're spending our resources in terms of the languages and stuff, and making sure that our early learners have the tools when they move on to the middle school and the high school. And by doing that, we need to make sure we have the resources like TAs or teachers in the elementary classes so they get the fundamentals so that when it comes time to move on, they have the tools in their toolbox to do so. And then my last priority, I didn't really think about it until Kathy had said something about the school today, that one-room schoolroom. If it is on the historical side and we do have ownership part of it, I do think as a responsible citizen, which was my second thing, we need to own up to doing our rightful duty and taking care of the assets that we have. And if it calls for putting some resources in there, then we should try to see what we can try to put together. That's all.
Great. Thank you, Alan. Teresa?
I'm echoing what a lot of people have already said, but my first priority was enrichment. My son had that when he was in fifth grade at our elementary school, and it, right after that, it went away when he was in sixth, and I just thought it was a huge resource, and I just really wish that we could put that back in. I just think it was wonderful for him to be able to partake in. Another thing was the TAs and social workers that was also mentioned. I think it's something that we need. We need to make sure that, especially at an elementary level, that these students are able to get the attention that they need. When a teacher has a classroom of 20 plus students, and a lot of them are 23, 24, at that age, you really do need that additional assistance. They can't do it all. They can't attend to all of those students at the same time when some child is struggling or some group of children are struggling. The other thing that I really wanted to kind of bring about is athletics. I'm a huge proponent of sports, and I think it's really important that children are able to partake in sports. We did get rid of some freshman sports that I'd like to see come back. And also just the overall, I'll just say a quick little blurb. My children are all involved in music and arts and athletics. And I feel that with music and art, as much as I make it a huge emphasis on them, that they need to partake in those things. And they enjoy art. Music is something that I kind of instill in them that they need to do. But I feel that those two facets of their lives are something that a parent and maybe a grandparent and an aunt and uncle will love to go see when they perform on stage or what have you, or when they have something on display, that parent or grandparent, aunt and uncle will go see. However, the athletics, I think, is a huge community facet of our lives. It's not just grandparents, parents, grandparents. It's everybody. Whether you're a neighbor, you're a friend, or whoever, everybody goes to athletic events. And I just feel that it should be encouraged and not put to the side and not funded as it could be.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Seema?
I just really went by the leadership minutes that we were given and things that stood out to me. So the first thing, I made the broad category, of academic support at the elementary level. So that could be inclusive of the social worker, language arts coordinator, and E&L support at the elementary level. Also, maybe TA time in kindergarten. You know, that was taken away from full day before. The second is just to overall to maintain or reduce class size, however, you know, however that works. The third thing you guys touched about already is the citizenship and digital citizenship. If you think about things that have happened here locally and globally, I think that's an important priority, especially right now. Talking about brought up bullying, even digital bullying. And one other thing that was on there that on the minutes that no one mentioned yet was the maybe looking at some ways to deal with the bus driver shortage.
That's a good one.
We're all going to get our CDL. And pitch in.
Yeah. You don't want me there.
No, I meant DOT.
Oh, okay.
Okay, Barbara?
Okay, Marion, many comments on enrichment. I would very much like to see if we could get enrichment back into the elementary schools. And also an encouragement on the part of our social workers, not social workers, guidance counselors, to get our senior students to, you know, take it almost a full class load. I mean, they are really wasting their parents' tax dollars when they're, you know, taking so few courses from what we learned last year. So I would hope that, you know, we could get our staff to encourage the kids to take advantage of what's here, even if it's an elective that they may want to explore or whatever. So that would be the one thing, the enrichment. The other thing that Teresa mentioned that I really would hope many other people would think about is at least getting our girls' freshman basketball team back on the docket. I think most of our other freshman teams have been restored. I may be wrong there. But I know that the girls' basketball program really, really needs a freshman basketball team. They have a modified, a JV, and a varsity. But you really need that bridge, ideally, to develop a good program. So I would hope that that, you know, would be part of our budget enhancement. And the other thing, again, having to do with the sports, the Dutchman committed that we heard about last year, I would like to see at least a small stipend in the budget to help them with the work that they're doing. And maybe at some point they issue a follow-up report on, you know, is it helping our sports program at all. Again, exploring the earlier start time. We've talked about it, and Chris has said, you know, let's see if we can really do it. There are a number of schools now in the area that seem to be exploring it, you know, through the superintendent's group. So if we can do it, fine. And again, the social workers and TAs, we've heard time and time again, at least in the lower grades, that they would appreciate some more TA time.
Is it because you've been on the board longer that you get more?
The what?
You got five. We're supposed to get through it. Oh, I heard that and. I could have done that, put little commas in between.
Yeah. It has six.
Where there's a will, there's
six,
a
and we only got three.
Notice on the list, I wrote seniors should take more classes, Barb said. See,
yeah, Barb said, I saw that.
I knew you were going to say
that. That was funny.
I just want to add one thing. I'm not
teasing
just
you.
Just the process, like having this template and getting the minutes from the leadership meeting.
That was very helpful.
Way more helpful
way
productive
helpful.
This time than last year's.
But I think way helpful.
And the year before.
The leadership one, though, I think it would have been, if you do this next time, is like, ask them a similar question. You know, like, to expand it to exactly the three options we had. You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
I think then we could see sometimes.
I mean, we can absolutely do that. We just used our usual stage one, stage two process. So we started stage two this week. So this was a way, honestly, we had never done the activity with a leadership team where we had all 26 administrators in the room and everybody shared what their priorities were. So we can fine-tune mm-hmm. as we go along.
Okay, sure. Thank you, Barbara. Okay, so when I was putting together my priorities, I kind of was looking at the whole child and nurturing the entire child. So at the very top of my list are support for Dutchman Committed, as well as putting in more gender-neutral bathrooms and changing areas. I'd also like to see more partnerships with local businesses where we can maybe have some internships that will help prepare students for when they enter the workforce or for the next steps if they go into college. And then I think Seema worded this in a nice way so that you can get more in under this topic, but academic support for the elementary schools, which would include TAs, social work, more ENL staff, and the language arts coordinator, which I believe several administrators had mentioned as priorities on their lists. So that's all I have for now. I think that's three, right?
Well.
Creative three.
Creative three. Yeah.
Christine, could I just ask Anil a question on the schoolhouse? My recollection is that many years ago, either it had asbestos in it, there was some complication of our doing work on the building. Do you remember what it was?
Yeah, look through the file, and there's lead paint issues in there. Asbestos, lead paint, definitely. There was mention of possibly asbestos that would have to be taken care of. Again, it's a historic building, so you can't just hire any contractor to come in. It has to be a contractor approved to work on historic buildings using appropriate materials that are regulated by being on the National Historic Register. So it's not as simple as our staff going in and making improvements or hiring a contractor to do that.
But it's something that's really sort of grant tasty, because it's a historic building, and so maybe we could explore those areas or member items or something along those lines. Mm-hmm. Did you have a price? I think it was pretty expensive when you mentioned it many years ago.
Yeah, we did that. That's a business practices. A couple of years ago, we went through this whole discussion.
Yeah, I mean, there's a lot of work. We haven't priced it out. We talked about getting some price quotes. We haven't done that. There's issues with the floor. There's actually, removal of the lead paint. There's issues with the windows. The roof was done in 2003, so I'm a little surprised to hear that the roof is leaking, because that is the newest addition.
Well, that was just somebody who commented there is holes in it. I mean, I couldn't really... I mean, it's hard to really see it, but I know that somebody who lives nearby probably has a different view of it.
I'm not aware that it's leaking inside, but the roof was the last thing that was replaced, and that was a preservation activity back in 2003.
It's been a while.
Yes. Mm-hmm. But significant amount of work that would have to be done.
And because
building.
We don't use it for any, we used to use it.
Yep.
We used to bring tours through and so on. It has no electricity, no heat. Those sorts of issues as well. So,
what about the old DO building? Are there plans for that?
The
old DO building? I mean, Kathy's question just made me think about the district office, the old one in
front
of the
trailer.
Yes.
Are there any plans for that?
The plan is to demolish that at some point. So. Yes.
Okay. I was just wondering.
Yep.
That was before you got on.
I don't think it's historic.
Historic in a couple of different ways.
I think it was an old golf course building or something.
Yes, it used to be a shack for golf carts. Yes.
There were a lot of problems with that building, as I recall.
Any?
Yep.
Alan?
I just have two things. With the building that you're talking about, where I used to work on Watertown, we had a historic foundry, and there was a lot of federal assistance with when we went and modernized our plant. If you use the existing structure, because it was a registered historical site. So it might be worth our efforts to see if there's some grants or some type of federal assistance we can get, since that building is on the national historical thing, so that we could, maybe it would help get some of the repairs that Kathy's said it's in need of.
Yeah.
And the second thing I was going to comment on is this was much better in the 5 years or 6 years I've been on the board of having the priorities, of having this whole list of things in front of us. So I applaud whosever ideas this was and whoever brought it.
Communications Committee.
I thought it was an excellent, excellent job, and it was a job well done.
Make a bow.
Thank you for that. Are there any other comments or input? Okay.
They've got a lot to
do.
Well.
I think we have plenty.
Stop it there, right?
All right, so with that, we'll move on to the consent agenda, and included in that are the minutes of the regular meeting of November 15th, 2016, the CPSE and CSE recommendations, personnel action items, and the financials. May I have a motion to approve or to approve the consent agenda? Chris? Second. Barbara? Are there any questions?
I have just a couple questions.
Sure. Alan?
Really not questions. Can we, when we're looking at the expenses and also the revenue, the two sheets that are in there, it's hard, or at least when I looked at it, it was hard for me to determine where we are in reference to the some of the encumbrances, because if you look at some of the salaries that are over there, there's some big chunks of salary money that I guess I question why it wouldn't be encumbered yet. This is a bad example, but the substitute teachers, I would expect that not to be encumbered because you have no idea when you're going to use substitutes, but there were a couple other salary categories down there. So when we do the report for next time, can we get some maybe a little bit of insight as to like what's behind some of those numbers in that section? I'll be more specific. I just,
yeah.
I can't remember because I read it and I forgot to do the homework assignment to give it to you today, but I want to just put it in my memory to go back and have you give us a little bit of insight as to like how we're doing against our plan of spending. Because like last year we were really underspent by a lot. I just want to just kind of see if we're on that same pace again.
Yeah, mostly contractual salaries, which we know we're going to pay throughout the course of the year. Those are the ones that are encumbered, but those that aren't contractually obligated are the ones that aren't encumbered. That's the simple explanation. But
okay.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Passes 9-0. Next item on the agenda are the information items, curriculum and instruction. Damian?
Thank you, Christine. First, some news from the music department. They are, of course, very proud to announce that we have four students who have been recognized by the New York State Band Directors Association. Each year, from hundreds of applicants, honor band members are chosen based upon their NISMA score from the previous spring. Each ensemble rehearses and performs during the New York State Band Directors Annual Symposium that's held at the Syracuse Convention Center from March 3rd through 5th in 2017. Selected to perform in the high school honor band under the direction of Dr. Evan Feldman from the University of North Carolina at Chapel Hill will be Jason Sindoni on tuba. Performing with the middle school honor band will be Marie Collison on horn, Aiden Doyle on trombone, and Aiden Fusco on trumpet. Dr. Shelley Jago of Wright State University of Dayton, Ohio will conduct the middle school honor band. Selection to these prestigious ensembles demonstrates exceptional musicianship and is an outstanding accomplishment. We, of course, want to extend congratulations to these fine musicians and their teachers, Mrs. Kathleen Ellinger and Mr. Jason Utter. Then my second item this evening, we've had many teachers, several of whom you met this evening, who have been actively presenting their skills and expertise within the region and across the state. On November 22nd, Farnsworth Middle School teachers Joe Winchester and Stephen Wolf presented at the New York State Computers and Technology and Education State Conference in Rochester. Their first presentation, and I'm not making this up, was entitled Two Bald Dudes Battle, Google Apps for Education Tips and Tricks, taught attendees about a variety of applications and extensions which can be used to enhance the Google environment. Their second session, titled Google Sites in the Classroom, again with two bald dudes, focused on the use of Google Sites as a tool to document learning in a web-based environment, and both of those sessions were very well attended. On Friday, December 2nd, several Guilderland Central School District teachers also shared their expertise during the annual NARIC Technology Awareness Day that was held at the Radisson Hotel on Wolf Road. We had Westmere Elementary teacher, first grade teacher Sarah Richardson, presented to a full house. Her session was titled Documenting Learning, Even a First Grader Can Do It, and of course Sarah was here with her students tonight. She was joined by several of and they were different students actually last week. And we also had two of our elementary math specialists, Todd Mell and Meg DiMartino, present a session called Data-Driven Decision-Making, a Math Interventionist Approach. During the session, they highlighted their use of a diagnostic assessment tool called iReady. And I have to apologize because I had an oversight when I wrote this. At the NARIC Technology Awareness Day, we also had Lisa O'Brien, who's a fourth grade teacher at Westmere, was a co-presenter on the New York State's field testing for computer-based testing last spring, so she was able to give a presentation on her experience with the state field testing. So my apologies to Lisa for not catching that earlier. And then finally, I'm pleased to share that Farnsworth Middle School math teacher Susan Ugelski has been nominated to work on New York State Education Department's 7-person Mathematics Standards Review Committee. This committee has been charged with review of the draft mathematics learning standards. The work will consist of making final revisions to the document to ensure that language formatting is consistent, the expectations are aligned vertically, and that there is a clear progression of content from grade and course to grade and course. We're thrilled to have a Guilderland teacher serving in this capacity. It's a great honor for her, and a well-deserved honor, but it's also great for the district to have someone at the table in that conversation at the state level. So we want to extend congratulations and thanks to all of our outstanding teachers for their contributions in the region and across the state.
Great, thank you. Now we move on to school business information. Neil?
I have one item this evening, and it's water testing for lead, and we have more results to report. On November 29th, the district received the high school's water testing results, which includes 171 outlets throughout the building with readings above the action level of 15 parts per billion out of a total of 318 samples. The vast majority of outlets exceeding the threshold are science lab sinks, bathroom and locker room sinks, and classroom sinks. Four outlets used for drinking and or cooking exceeded the action level. There were two drinking fountains, one kitchenette sink, and one kitchen sink in the small cafeteria. As of December 1st, all outlets exceeding the action level have been taken offline or have been labeled for hand washing use only. These outlets will not be used for drinking or cooking until follow-up test results indicate that the lead levels are at or below the action level.
Thank you, Neil. Are there any questions or comments for Neil? Barbara?
I have a question. For those schools that we identified, you know, earlier, the remediation that we've done, have we discovered why there's lead? Is it the fixtures themselves, or?
We're still going through the investigation process. We don't have those answers yet.
So have we considered, like, trying another lab? I mean, these numbers are phenomenal.
The lab is an approved lab. The testing protocol is an approved testing protocol. So it is back to what is the possible source, and that's what our professionals are working on right now, evaluating that.
So how do we figure that out? I mean, who actually does the testing, you know, of the faucets and things? Is it engineers or our own staff?
Yes, it's our architectural engineering firm that will be working on that.
I just have a quick question about the testing. So when they did the elementary schools, if there was a water fountain, let's say, that wasn't working, and obviously couldn't test it, and then they moved on and went to the other schools, if the water fountain started working after, do we go back? And
yes, if we were unable to take a sample because there was an issue with a particular faucet, we have gone back and tested those. So everything's been tested.
Teresa?
Are the districts going to be responsible for the financial?
Yes.
Undertaking?
Yeah. Yes. There is an element of state aid involved, so we will. There's a reporting process for that. So we're still waiting for a final clarification, but the belief right now is that it will be partially aided, not fully aided on all of our costs.
I don't know what that partial means. If it's 10%,
It should be in our case about 65%. So, but we're still waiting for clarification.
I'll take 65 versus zero.
Yeah. Anything else? Okay, so we'll move on to superintendent information. Marie?
Okay, my first item is an update on our strategic planning initiative. The process for selecting a facilitator for the district strategic planning initiative continues. Last week, on November 30th, the review committee, who was charged with evaluating the five responses to our request for proposals, met and selected two respondents to participate in an interview with that committee. And those interviews are going to be held tomorrow evening, beginning at the first interview is at 6:30. We're meeting at 6 to get organized. The review committee is comprised of individuals representing parents, teachers, administrators, and board members. The committee used a 100-point rubric to guide the review process. And then after the interviews, the committee will have the option of selecting one of the current respondents to recommend to the board or recommending that we seek out additional responses. So we'll have more information at this time tomorrow.
Who's the board rep?
Judy and Barbara. Okay, My next item, I just want to say a few words about a week ago, the recent high school threat that we had to deal with. Early in the morning of November 29th, the Guilderland High School administrators received an email threat that required that our school district and law enforcement initiate a speedy and thorough response. We're all relieved that the threat turned out to be unfounded, but I'd like to take this opportunity to recognize the people who responded. I'll begin with our leadership team at the high school. They exemplified calm leadership, genuine teamwork, and an overwhelming commitment to keep our students and our staff safe, even while preserving as much normalcy to the school day as was possible. I also want to thank our faculty, staff, and the students at GHS who were very much cooperative and willing to help in our, as we worked our way through that incident. And then lastly, I want to thank and recognize the Guilderland Police Department for their quick initial response and then their resourcefulness of bringing additional law enforcement agencies to assist, and then ultimately their swift and successful investigation. And we value and appreciate the Guilderland Police Department and our partnership with them and their service to our district and community. And yesterday I mailed a letter to Chief Lawler to express that personally so that they know we really appreciate all the good work that they do. And next, I want to recognize our district's recycling coordinator, Renee Panetta, and the good work she and her team did at our fall recycling extravaganza at Farnsworth Middle School. This was our 12th biannual event on November 29th. And our total October 29th. Our total car count was 512, which was one of our highest. And then we collected an amazing number of pounds of things, 18,990 pounds of metals and electronics, over 9,000 pounds of clothing and soft textiles, 3,880 pounds of mixed recyclables, 103 bikes, 1,400 pounds of books, 5,000 plastic bags, over 1,000 bottles and cans. So it was truly an extravaganza. So we are thankful to Renee and the work that she does every year to help keep the planet green. So we're pleased with that work.
Spring one, April 29th.
And the spring one is coming up on April 29th. I missed the one on October 29th. I got to get on it. My next item... The Communications Committee has been working with our communications specialist, Aubrey Kamler, to create an infographic, which is now posted to our website. It's called Your Voice Matters, and it looks like this. I think it was all in your packet on Friday. And the purpose of our information page here is to communicate to the community when they can participate in the budget development process. So we're working on a plan to send out an SNN to link this, and also we're looking at putting it in backpack mail so it is right home to families so folks can understand when they can participate.
But they should know they can participate
at any time. There, right, any place you see red on here, Guilderland red, is a time to jump in if you so choose. And then my last item, we added as a supplement because I didn't want us to get all the way to January before we recognized this latest project. This past summer, we wrote a letter of support for the Village of Altamont to participate in a grant-funded program called Museum in the Streets. The grant was funded, and what it turns out it does, it's an excellent opportunity for the school district to partner with the village to help create engaging educational experiences in both history and language for our students in the community. The Museum in the Streets project consists of a series of panels with images and text in English and Spanish that are placed in various historically significant sites within the Altamont community. Visitors, residents, and students from our school district are able to stroll the streets of Altamont and read and learn about the local history and architecture of the community. And the panels become another voice through which the village can tell its story in a way for our students to learn more about their community and to practice the reading and comprehension of a second language. So I just received a letter from Mayor Gaughan indicating that the property right in the front yard of Altamont Elementary School, the site of the old Altamont High School, will be one of those locations with the panel describing what had happened. And I got a very nice letter from the mayor, and I didn't want too much time to go by before we made this as a public announcement. So there you have it.
Great, thank you. Are there any comments or questions for Marie? Okay, we'll move on to the action items, school business management action. Neil?
Thank you, Christine. First item this evening is a service agreement, and that what is recommended for approval is an agreement with Vanderheiden for the provision of programs and services for two of our students with disabilities whose needs are best met through an alternative education program. Vanderheiden is located in Wineskill and serves children with special developmental, emotional, and behavioral needs.
May I have a motion to approve the service agreement? Judy, second. Kathy, any questions? Okay, all those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Passes 9-0.
Next is a recommendation to renew a bid for uniform mop and mat services. In November of 2015, the district conducted this bid and has specified a 54-month contract award subject to annual renewal by the district. That bid was awarded to UniFirst. Cliff Nooney and Stan Dean, who's our Director of Custodial Services, are satisfied with products, pricing, and services received and wish to renew the agreement for a second year. And just in case you want to know exactly what this bid covers, it's the supplying and cleaning of uniforms for our maintenance, custodial, and bus mechanic employees, laundering of dust mops, and the supplying and cleaning of entrance mats for each of our school buildings during the winter season.
Okay, may I have a motion to renew the bid? Gloria, second. Alan, any questions? All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Passes 9-0.
Next is a recommendation for obsolete and surplus equipment. There's a list of items that are attached in your materials that we no longer need and are putting up to bid for whoever wants to submit the highest bid. That's who will get the award. We have a formal process for collecting those bids, sealed bids from individuals and businesses. And again, based on the recommendation of the supervisor of the area where the item came from, if we believe we're getting good value from the item, we will award that to the highest bidder.
Okay, may I have a motion to approve the recommendation of the declaration of surplus and obsolete property? Barbara, second. Seema, are there any questions or comments? Okay, all those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Passes 9-0.
Next is a private transportation contract, and this is for transportation of the students that I talked about previously that are attending Vanderheiden, located in Wineskill. The recommendation is to award the bid to Star and Strand Transportation, who is the sole respondent to the bid.
Okay, may I have a motion to approve the recommendation to approve the bid? Judy, second. Teresa, are there any questions on this item? Alan?
Do we know why we sent out 10 solicitations and we only got one response?
Everybody's in the same boat. What we're hearing for private contractors, they're experiencing the same thing that we're experiencing in our schools. It's a shortage of drivers, and it's hitting everybody. So.
And is the shortage because the pay is so low, or is it because of other reasons?
We're not quite sure whether it's a lack of interest in transporting children, the requirements of the position, the pay. But it's not just being experienced by Guilderland, it's being experienced by other school districts and private contractors as well.
Yep. It's off topic, but now because Alan asked that question, do we do, because I know we talk about the bus drivers at our own school, do we do exit surveys or ask individuals when they leave Guilderland?
When we hold retirement meetings, every employee has the opportunity to sit and chat with us. Our teachers generally meet with Marie, and then our non-instructional staff meets with me. So we give them the option.
Right.
I usually engage them in a great conversation when they're pursuing the idea to retire, and then they have the option to talk again.
I wonder for bus drivers, even if it's just maybe they don't want to sit down, but even a piece of paper, just to find out what the reason is. I know we did something last year to try to entice, drivers. So just to find out what the reason is. I mean, if it is a shortage, it's a shortage, but if there's something we can do, then I think we would be probably supportive of that. But it's hard to know if we don't know the reason.
Yep, I agree. I think that's a good point. Alan?
I just have one more comment. In the recommendation, since there was only one bid, can we in the future not write it was the low bidder? Because I don't know how we would know it would be the low bidder. It really is the only bidder.
Well, that's legal language. We have to award to the lowest responsible bidder, so if there's only one, that is the lowest responsible bidder, but that's wording of general municipal law.
Okay. It seems kind of odd, because if one bid, I mean, it could be outrageous. And
well, we don't have, it's a recommendation to award, because you can choose not to award as well, but there's two things. One is low bidder, one is responsible, so we have to determine that they're able to provide the services that they've indicated. So there's two elements to that particular statement.
I didn't realize it was the second element, because it doesn't.
Transportation, pizza makers, and the
okay, so are there any other questions or comments? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Passes 9-0. Thank you, Neil. And now we will move on to superintendent action. Marie?
I just have one item. We have a request to create a new co-curricular at the high school called the Jewish Association Club, where students hope to explore the Jewish culture through food and talking about the culture.
May I have a motion to approve the co-curricular club? Barbara, second. Seema, any questions or comments? Christopher?
Just to repeat what I said when we approved the Muslim Student Association, I think that if you're trying to get individuals to come in so you can talk about your culture, by calling anything a blank association club or blank student association, I think that's very difficult then to actually have people come to the club. And I think if you really want to talk about your culture, and also with the Muslim Student Association talking about what their goals were, I think it would be better if there was a culture club and bring everyone together. Especially after this election year, I think that would be good for everyone to have one club. I think we have to approve it because we approved the other one, but that was my same concern when we approved the last one. It's just my two cents.
I would agree with that.
Thank you, Alan. Anyone else, Barbara?
There is an international club at the high school that over the years has been very, very successful. And that is basically what you're proposing, but it really does exist.
Mm-hmm. But for these two clubs, they talk more about, I know as well, but they would talk more about their culture and talking about their culture. So to me, they both have the same club purpose. I think if you bring them together, they would actually achieve their purpose.
Okay. Thank you for that. Anything else? Okay, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Passes 9-0. Next item on the agenda is board president action, which is the approval of several policies. Barbara, would you like to speak to this?
These are the policies that you were presenting with last meeting, and basically mundane things that we just have to update as to procedures for board meetings and some purchasing bids. I haven't heard anything from anybody, so I'm assuming we don't have any questions on them.
Okay, thank you. May I have a motion to approve the policies? Alan, second. Kathy, are there any questions or comments or changes? Okay. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Passes 9-0. Next item on the agenda is board committee reports. Audit, Alan?
Hi. We met yesterday. We met with the internal auditor, and we developed that we were going to have the internal auditor look at the capital project that is just coming to a close. That's the first thing he's going to look at, and then if there's time permitting, I think he's going to come back and look at, wasn't it attendance we wanted to look at?
Yep.
Attendance. And then the second thing that we did on our agenda was to review the claims auditor reports, and those went through fine. The only comment that was on there that the district office administrators made note of was the fact that the HR system and the payroll system have conflicting, I won't say conflicting, they just had different data elements in it, and they verified that the elements that were used to calculate the bills and stuff were the proper elements, and I think they took the proper corrective action to update the HR plan so that both databases are in sync with each other. And we currently don't have a meeting scheduled, but when Neil and his staff feel the need to have the next meeting, we'll send out a meeting doodle for that.
I did send it out.
Okay. Any questions?
Nope, no questions on that. I think the doodle poll went out, so if you haven't seen it, it's probably there. Okay, business practices?
We are meeting Monday, December 12th at 8:15 in the district office.
Okay. Communications?
We are meeting Friday, December 16th at 7:45 at Guilderland Elementary School, room 701.
Where is 701?
We walk
Does anybody
in.
Know?
You walk when we in. Walk in to we'll go in, which it. Way do we go?
Go up to the first intersection, take a right, all the way down that hallway.
First intersection right.
Just before where the staff room is, where?
You turn right, that's right.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. Policy committee?
We have a meeting coming up on the 13th at 5:45.
The next item is public comment number 2. Linda, do we have anybody signed up? Okay, no public comment. Then we will move on to our last item, which is board issues, ideas, and sharing. Does anybody have anything they'd like to share?
I know some of us went to the Focus family, the volunteer day, which was, I had a lot of fun. I mean, the kids are wonderful. We helped out at the Altamont Food Pantry, which is housed at St. Lucie's, and worked at sorting food and making pumpkin pies, a whole bunch of them, and the kids had a wonderful time. Unfortunately, I couldn't stay for the lunch, which is always wonderful, and I'm sure it was.
It was.
Again.
Yes.
But I really like to thank the staff, because this year the invitation didn't just include the lunch. They said, if you want to come, it was wonderful to do the volunteer work. I know you were there, right, Teresa? You were at the church, Hamilton Union. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And Gil and I were there, and Marie was there.
Yeah. It was great. It was great. I'd like to thank the staff of that program.
Yeah.
Thanks, Amy.
Anyone else? Okay. Without that, we are not in need of an executive session. So can I have a motion to adjourn the meeting? Barbara, second.
We have to fill out our evaluation things.
Which is connected to the Friday update.
Oh.
Okay.
In Acela.
And when I try to open it, was it that you can't?
I couldn't open mine.
I couldn't open
it. Kept saying you need permission.
Maybe we could do it at home.
I couldn't open it.
Okay.
I didn't know if we needed the end of the meeting to give us permission.
Right, to give you access?
No.
It wouldn't give us.
I'm in it right now, so.
Oh, Alan.
You are?
Yeah.
Okay,
see, maybe with the Chromebook you can. I think with PCs you can't. I couldn't. Try it now.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, I just logged out.
Okay, so we can adjourn the meeting and then fill out the surveys?
Yes.
Correct.
Okay, all those in favor?
Aye.
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 Opposed? Passes 9-0. Thank you.
See, I need permission, Damien. This is